You're listening to the audio production of The Kindred Life, stories and recipes to cultivate a life of organic connection by Christine Marie Bailey, published by Harper Horizon and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperfocusaudio.com.
To Jesus, my rescuer, friend, comforter, and guide, you have saved me, spoken love over me, given me a voice, walked beside me, fought my battles every single day of my life. In the end, it's you and me. The world will tell you how to live if you let it. Don't let it. Take up your space, raise your voice, sing your song. This is your chance to make or remake a life that thrills you. Shauna Nyquist, Present Over Perfect. Chapter 1, Sing Your Song. Have you ever heard a mockingbird singing in the middle of the night? One evening, tucked under my white comforter in our cozy 1940s farmhouse, I did. It stirred my husband, Stephen, and me as we were drifting away in that drowsy state of almost but not quite asleep. "That's one confused mockingbird," he mumbled, while I lay there alert in wonder. For the next 30 minutes, its solo song delightfully haunted me. During the day on our land in Tennessee, birdsong is usually accompanied by many other sounds. Hums of mowers and cars whizzing down the country road at 50 miles per hour, our little girls' voices and giggles, our cats' meows, dramatic chicken cackles, all the banging and clanging of daily farm life. As the state bird of Tennessee, mockingbirds are common here. They serenade us from the treetops above the produce field and from the barn roof apex. They dive bomb us when we pass too closely to their nests. But a single mockingbird singing an ever-changing song in the middle of the night outside our bedroom window? This was a first. It had me pondering, did it not know it was nighttime? Did it realize it was the only one singing? Did it even care? We moved to our land in Tennessee in December 2016, the dead of winter. It had been a farm in World War II times, but no remnant of anything fruitful remained except for a totally endearing yet scraggly apple tree enjoyed primarily by squirrels. We settled into the restored olive green farmhouse on 17 acres of possibility and started drawing our plans for our dreams: to beautify the land, to make it a home for us and for animals, to grow organic food for us and the community, and to gather people around the table at farm dinners filled with abundance. We broke ground on the first day of spring 2017, and before that, I'd never farmed a day in my life. Stephen and I had dreamed of having our own farm one day, but when it became a reality, I resisted it wholeheartedly at first, fearing the potential isolation of living in the country and not knowing if I was cut out for the taxing manual labor of birthing a farm. Grit was practically a foreign word to me. I didn't like pushing through hard things, and my first instinct was to quit when situations got too tough, messy, or uncomfortable. Heck, I didn't even like being dirty, and I really, really liked wearing makeup. But only 3 months after that groundbreaking day, I'd worn some serious creases into my leather farm boots, and my palms had not one, but two rows of calluses. We'd transformed a huge open field full of 3-foot-tall weeds into a lush organic garden, a half acre of every shade of green, vines heavy with cucumbers snaking the ground, armfuls of magenta radishes and crimson beets, mini forests of kale and rainbow chard. People were buying our stuff at farmers markets. The meadows where the piglets roamed were regrowing a deep emerald green. As the land was being transformed, something inside me was healing and growing too. You see, I've always struggled to find what's uniquely mine to offer the world. One of the biggest misconceptions I had growing up in the church was that I had to have a certain personality to truly shine and contribute something meaningful. It seemed the boisterous, extroverted, gregarious girls were the ones who were celebrated. and there was somehow something wrong with me since I didn't want to be the center of attention. My more reserved and artistic personality, talents, and gifts seemed more hidden and less important. So I was easily compliant, merging with others' dreams and plans in an effort to avoid conflict and struggle. All the while, desires burned within me to point others to beauty, to gather people together in a meaningful way, to have a life infused with bravery and adventure, to appreciate the body God has given me, as imperfect as it is. A song has been deep inside all along, waiting to be sung. Oh, I've had plenty of chances to do the things I truly love. I grew up an Italian-American girl in New Jersey and ventured off on my own to Tennessee for college. In my early to mid-20s, I had a job I loved in the music industry, journeyed to India and Kenya and Uganda, and helped start an Africa relief organization. I began blogging and freelance writing to share the words that wanted to pour out of me. By my early 30s, I became a mother, the number one job I've always wanted. I was delightfully immersed in new motherhood, and even with a little daughter underfoot, and then a few years later, a second one, I still built in outlets for creativity, nature, adventure, and play. I was surprised by the new fierceness and boldness that surfaced when it came to protecting my family's values or my daughter's childhood. Yet, I still clung to safety and predictability when I was on my own. By the time my late 30s approached, I felt a deep stirring to learn more about myself and my capabilities. What did I uniquely have to offer? And was there even more I could learn and experience if I opened myself up to risk and change? Shortly after we began farming day to day, I was presented with a choice: continue shrinking back in fear, or start showing up in courage. I dipped my pinky toe into a new life, setting, and vocation, showing up in my vulnerable yet authentic self. And the world didn't end. It actually felt really good. Soon, I began to see a pattern developing. Walk through uncertainty and discomfort with every bit of courage I can muster. Push through challenges. Grow. See how much better it is on the other side. On a farm, you don't get to choose whether or not you want to do hard things. That first farming season, I learned how to properly handle a chicken. I learned how to fix the myriad irrigation leaks. I learned how to seed a cover crop without dumping the whole bag of seeds in one spot again. Oops. I learned how to podcast, speak the truth more boldly, play the ukulele, and write for my first print magazine. I accomplished these things not because of some sort of magic and not because I wasn't afraid sometimes, but because I just began. And each time, I had a little more courage to keep going. Over the last several years since we founded the farm, my body has been pushed to its physical limits. I've worked muscles I didn't even know existed to lift soil with the broad fork, hammer stakes, and use what's appropriately called the farmer walk to haul a bucket of water with each arm up a hill. I've broken down when it all seemed too much, when butternut squash was taken over by beetles, when we lost 2 months of lettuce seedlings to pests, and when I felt like I couldn't spend one more single day of summer sweating down to my underwear by 7:30 a.m. Of all the things I thought I could possibly be, a farmer was never one of them. But to my complete and utter surprise, I've found a deep well of strength and joy while digging into the soil of Kindred Farm. After struggling with body image for much of my life, I've learned my body is stronger than I ever thought possible. Now, even though body image is still a big challenge for me, I know I'd rather be strong than a certain size, and that my beauty glows from the inside out. Yes, even through a sweaty, makeup-free face that's been harvesting lettuce for hours. Sifting soil through my hands has made my faith more real, and I feel more connected to the earth God gave me, both for its beauty and its functionality. I'm a partner in redeeming that earth little by little through growing food and flowers and sharing fruits of the earth with others in a way that helps us all slow down and connect. Looking back, I can see how every step of the journey has led me to this place where I truly, finally feel at home. welcoming people to our land, and pursuing a nourishing life of connection, infused with both beauty and grit. With all the blunders, mistakes, and learning experiences, I'm finding my voice and the song that's uniquely mine to sing. So, do you want to know what I discovered about why a mockingbird sings in the middle of the night? In his article for the Los Angeles Times, biologist and science writer William Jordan shared a similar story of being awakened in the dark by a soul mockingbird singing loudly. He explained that although mockingbirds can be territorial, they don't want to fight physically because of potential injury that would cost them too much. So they rely on the vigor and skill of their songs. The mockingbird I heard singing in the middle of the night was singing for his family's survival, and singing was the measure of his substance and grit. In my mind, I had romanticized birdsong into a joyous rainbows and butterflies scene from children's storybooks. But here's the truth. Mockingbirds don't just sing for joy. They sing because they have to. There's both a strength and beauty to the mockingbird's gorgeous, gritty song, and to my song, and to your song too. And here's the great news. A life of organic connection isn't something that only happens on a farm in Tennessee. It happens in your suburban neighborhood, your city living room. It's not about where you live, but how. Maybe you need to be nourished on a soul level because right now you feel depleted and unable to love others or yourself well. Maybe you desperately want a childhood that unravels slowly for your children and a slower, less busy, less chaotic life, but you don't know how to change things. Maybe you've buried some of your gifts and desires because of fear of what it might take to just go for it, or because of others' expectations of what your life should look like. Maybe you ache for a life of deep community, but don't know how to find it or if it's even possible anymore. This book is for you. The Kindred Life is a rally cry for connection in a time when we need to recapture what's been lost in the chaos of busyness, distraction, and isolation. We find it again by investing in the things that have always mattered and fed our souls since the beginning of time: authentic connection with flesh and blood people, the soil beneath our feet, and life around the table. This is a return to what is good. This is a reclaiming. It's time to sing the song you've been given to sing, to push through challenges, start walking out dreams that have been hidden in your heart, and take steps forward in flickering moments of bravery so you can live the kindred life you're meant to live. Come along on this journey with me, and you'll learn what it means to cultivate a rich, nourishing life of organic connection right where you are. But first, let's go back to where it all began, on a January afternoon in the middle of a blizzard in Branson, Missouri. This chapter is about voice. We all have a song inside that's waiting to be sung. Our voices may be gritty and imperfect at first, but it's time to start singing. What does bravery mean to you? Name a time when you felt the most you've ever been. Write a few thoughts about when and where you were and how it felt. While reading this chapter, what inner song began to come to the surface? Pay attention to that now and make note of what you're sensing. What does your unique voice sound and look like? What are you proud of in yourself? What do you like about the life you're living? What are some things you'd like to change? In the accompanying PDF, you can find a reference version of the reflection questions that close each chapter and some of my favorite recipes. It turns out that playing it safe, at least in matters of the heart, is the most dangerous thing you can do. By that route, you become a butterfly pinned to the wall, with wonderful colors and all kinds of potential, but going nowhere. Your wings are clipped. To really fly, you must claim the courage to live out of your real self, the one God called you into being. Paula Reinhart, Strong Women, Soft Hearts. Chapter 2, That Guy in Dallas. I saw him walking across the exhibit hall in a t-shirt, khakis, and vintage gray New Balance sneakers. He was doing this thing with his eyes that made me notice their almond shape and his long lashes. Now, 16 years later, I know he was just trying to read something in the distance. I recall what I was wearing, too, my favorite flare leg jeans and a long-sleeve asymmetrical neck black shirt. My curly hair was flat ironed and highlighted within an inch of its life. It was January 2004 in Branson, Missouri, and I was at the first ever conference for the college student leaders of Kanakuk Camps. I had been invited as a vendor because I was working with the leader of the conference to recruit street.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.